Hey guys, welcome to Collider movie talk for movie fans. I'm your host, Ashley Mova, and this is the daily show where we give you all the latest news from the world of movies, plus some insight into what it all means. Leading off the show today is John Campea.
Well, greetings and salutations, everybody. Welcome to the best damn movie-related show on the planet Earth, coming to you from right here at the Collider Video Studios here in Burbank, California, and we are so glad you decided to make us part of your day.
Also here, egg maker Perri Nemiroff. You can make eggs in the microwave. I can assure you that it's not bad. Try it.
Okay, one quick question. Do you put ketchup on your eggs?
No.
Good.
No.
Oh my gosh.
Oh my God. Ketchup and eggs were meant to be.
No, that is a sickness. That is an epidemic that is ruining
this
country.
Mark Ellis, tell us. Tiebreaker.
I don't get excited to eat eggs. I mean, I'll do it. I'll get in there. I'll have an egg, but I'm not like, oh boy, it's egg time. I'd rather fast forward to what I make in microwaves. Lean cuisine pizza, and I put a slice of cheese on top of it because I'm a culinary master.
That's a great tease for behind the scenes, because what I have for planned for you might involve some eggs. Eggs? Yeah,
what?
It does.
No, ketchup and eggs. Just stop. Just stop doing it.
I would prefer to not have ketchup with my eggs.
Oh, God.
Yeah. Oh, tell us in the comments. Ketchup with eggs, yes or no? Please say no. All right. Movie stuff. That's right. Let's talk about it. Ashley, what's going on?
In an interview with THR discussing Rogue One, A Star Wars Story, John Knoll, who created the story concept for the movie, revealed to the trade that he is working on another anthology idea set in the Star Wars universe. At the Rogue One Super Session panel, Knoll told THR, I have another idea I've been tinkering with. It's maybe 75% there. I haven't pitched it to Lucasfilm President Kathleen Kennedy. It's another Star Wars thing. There's no reason to think Disney is going to stop wanting to make Star Wars movies. If there's quality and there's interest, it has unlimited potential. It has a huge number of characters, worlds. It's a massive playground. John, thoughts on John Knoll doing another Star Wars anthology film at Lucasfilm?
Well, here's the thing. Like, my emotional attachment to John Knoll. Like, people who are into art may have their heroes, like this guy's my hero. The people who are into cars, oh, the guy who designed this. People who are into motorcycles, oh, the guy who first created the double, you know, exhaust transmission engine. I have no idea. I don't know anything about motorcycles. But I worked in visual effects for a number of years. And our small g god around our industry was John Knoll. We all loved and worshipped John Knoll. Now, John Knoll has been with Lucas and ILM for a long time. He was actually the visual effects supervisor of all the prequels. And say what you want about the prequels, those visual effects were so far ahead of their time. Like, they were just revolutionary what he did there. He is also the guy who created Photoshop. And a lot of people forget that. He's the guy who created Photoshop. And he's the one who came up with the idea for Rogue One. He's the chief creative officer over at Industrial Light and Magic. And he's still like the guru in visual effects. The guy's amazing. So the idea of him coming up with another idea is very appealing. I loved Rogue One. I really enjoyed that film. I just want him to focus on the second half of that quote. Can we bring up that quote graphic again for a second there, Adam, as he brings it up?
Oh, look, that's actually Photoshop.
That is actually, we used Photoshop to put a graphic together of the creator of Photoshop. It says, look, he says, as Disney isn't going to want to stop making Star Wars movies, if there's quality, then there's interest. It has unlimited potential. It has a huge number of characters, worlds. It is a massive playground. Then stop making movies about things we've already seen. I get the appeal. I got the appeal of Rogue One, because that's a cool question. What happened to lead up to that? But why does every anthology rumor we even hear, it's going to be a Yoda movie, it's going to be an Obi-Wan movie, and great, hey, I'm up for seeing an Obi-Wan movie, I am. It's going to be a Boba Fett movie, it's going to be a young Jabba movie, it's going to be a road comedy with, you know, Chewbacca and, I don't know, the Rancor when they were both...
Yes, yes, yes!
When they both had like a private detective agency together and they're like solving crimes.
Salacious Crumb's behind it, I know he is!
I'm just, the universe, the Star Wars is thousands of worlds with trillions of potential stories to tell. I just really want Star Wars, and I'm loving everything they put out so far, but I just want them to start exploring things that aren't all connected to the original trilogy at some point. Give us something fresh, something new. That's why whenever Christian brings up like Old Republic, I'm like, I'm on board. because you can just create your whole new thing within this universe that's there, that there's an unlimited number of stories to tell, and yet they continually seem to be shrinking the universe by only telling the stories we're already somewhat familiar with. I think Star Wars is now big enough, successful enough, that they can roll the dice, step outside of that very comfortable sandbox they got, and granted, that sandbox has been very successful. So I'm not knocking the sandbox, but I think it's time that they step out of that sandbox, and I hope with this comment, that's the kind of idea that John Knoll is going to bring to Kathleen Kennedy. I can only hope. Mark, you hear these comments. What do you think?
I just found out that John Knoll likes ketchup with his eggs, so I don't know what that does to your hero. Look, I'm very excited to hear that somebody wants to create a new movie in the Star Wars universe, particularly when it's John Knoll, who I thought did such a fantastic job getting Rogue One off the ground, because that was the way that Star Wars dipped their toes into the waters, all right? Yeah. You can't just be like Mandy Moore and jump 47 meters down. You got to dip your toes in there, and you got to see, hey, is there an appetite for this? And clearly there was, but that was the right entry point into more stories in the Star Wars world, is let's tell something that doesn't have any Skywalkers in it, but still is around that time period that we know. And then we get a little bit further away from that with Han Solo. So if you look at the Star Wars world and this particular, the time period that we're so familiar with, it's kind of like you're the fire marshal at a bar, and you let everybody in, and there's a lot of stories in there, and now it's like, okay, we're at capacity here. Okay, Han Solo, you can come in because you're famous, but nobody else can come in here. Let's go to another bar where there's plenty of open space, like an Old Republic. All you need to do is go on YouTube, and which you're on right now, and look at any of the Old Republic trailers for the video games. You're going to say, I want to build a movie around that. Now, as far as John Knoll being the guy, he's right down the hall. He clearly is great at pitching stuff to Kathleen Kennedy, so I'd like to see him pitch. I think Kathleen Kennedy is going to take thousands of pitches from thousands of different people, and I want all types of backgrounds pitching her ideas and have them select the most intriguing story. But I agree with Mr. Campea. I want to see them take a bold step in a new direction with Star Wars, and that means a different time period.
By the way, if somebody could put together and send me a poster of Rancor Chewbacca Investigations, a movie poster of that, I'd be very grateful. Okay,
we'll have that in 5 minutes. I see where you're coming from. I have a feeling why all of these rumors are about characters we already know is because they are characters that we already know, and because they're just that, they're rumors. So it just makes sense to me that if someone was to, you know, drop something on Twitter and make it start a story, they would think of Obi-Wan, Han Solo. And that's not to say that I don't think that's the direction Lucasfilm is going. I think they're probably going to consider characters that we're familiar with and then completely new things. And given the fact that I think the recent quote from Kathleen Kennedy said in like something like 6 to 8 months, that's when they're really going to start ramping up the anthology idea thing. That's probably why this quote is dropping now, because everybody at Lucasfilm and everybody who's a step away from Kathleen Kennedy is probably coming up with ideas, whether it's from, you know, characters we already know from the other movies or brand new things. But what makes me excited about his quotes is that him saying it has, you know, a huge number of characters and worlds and it's a massive playground, to me, kind of implies that that's the direction he's going, is that he's going to go way out there and start up something that we've never seen before, or at least that's what I'm hoping for. And if you guys don't know about all the history with this guy, there's this great piece on, I think it's on Wired right now, and it just breaks down all of these, I mean, really incredible things that he's created, from Photoshop to a million other things, and just his involvement in Lucasfilm and his rise up the ladder and how he made that Rogue One pitch into the actual movie. It's really an incredible career.
All right, what's next?
In a new report from IndieWire, the producers for James Bond are eyeing Lucky Number Slevin and Victor Frankenstein director Paul McGugin for the director's seat on the 25th James Bond movie. Producers Barbara Broccoli and Michael G. Wilson are reportedly very pleased with McGugin's upcoming film, Stars Don't Die in Liverpool, which is also being produced by Bond production house Eon. No more details have been offered at this time. Mark, what do you think about the possibility of Paul McGugin directing Bond 25?
Sure, I'd be up for it. It's not Sam Mendes, and I think that it's time for Daniel Craig, if he's going to be back as Bond, to have somebody new behind the camera directing the next Bond movie. This name, while it doesn't, as I'm frequent of saying, doesn't get me out of bed in the morning, there's a nice body of work there. And I think with Bond 25, you do the same thing that any major production would do, where you take somebody who's done a couple of smaller movies that have been critically acclaimed, they're good at telling a story, and you put them in this giant world to play with. I think that this could reinvigorate the James Bond franchise to some extent, and I think that it would be a nice send-off for Daniel Craig, because this has got to be the last one he's going to be doing.
I gotta assume so too. What do you think, Perri?
Yeah, I don't know how excited I am about this idea. I mean, you kind of said it. Had they announced a different name that had a stronger body of work or someone that I was, you know, a little more familiar with or had a stronger resume, maybe I would have been hyped about this. It seems like a very strange choice, especially coming off of Victor Frankenstein as his last movie. And I liked that movie more than most people. I mean, he's a really nice guy. I interviewed him for that, and he seems super bright. It's just, if I'm thinking about someone who's going to go from what they achieved with Spectre back to Skyfall levels, it's probably not him. And also, we just covered that report where the studios are bidding on the property right now. I just highly doubt that anybody would be in serious consideration for the job unless that had been settled, because doesn't the studio have some sort of say in who's going to direct the next movie?
Well, I mean, I don't think the distributor has much say in who's going to direct the movie. I think the production company itself has more say in that. What's interesting here is that the names that are being thrown around the most are Victor Frankenstein and Lucky Number Slevin, neither of which are all that good. Lucky Number Slevin wasn't bad, and actually Victor Frankenstein, despite, I think, the overall bad rep it gets, it wasn't actually all that bad, but it wasn't all that good either. The more interesting things on his resume to me are he did a big number of, I think at least four episodes of Sherlock Holmes that people really love. But the other one he did that I really actually liked, it was a little gem that nobody paid attention to, it quietly came and quietly went, was this little kind of sort of superhero film called Push with Dakota Fanning and Chris Evans.
Mm-hmm.
And Jaimon Hounsou was in that as well. I actually thought that was almost, like, if it was in the X-Men universe, that would have been a Logan-like movie before there was Logan. You know what I mean? And I actually thought his approach to that and the way he handled his characters and his narrative and that, I thought were really interesting. It's because of those titles, not so much Slevin or Frankenstein, that I think this would be a curious pick. I think it would be a curious pick. Like, it's one of those picks that I go, okay, that's interesting. Let's see where this goes. But like you, it's not a name that's going to get me out of bed in the morning. It's not one that's going to get me excited about the idea of it. But who knows? We'll just see where this thing goes. All right, guys. It is a Tuesday, which means it's time for us to talk about some films opening this week. And there's a rather significant one. Mm-hmm. Ashley, tell us about it.
It's Guardians of the Galaxy Volume 2. The team struggles to keep its newfound family together as it tries to unravel the mystery of Peter Quill's true parentage in the outer reaches of the galaxy.
All right, now I think all of us at this table have seen Guardians of the Galaxy Volume 2. What is really interesting now is the question is, what kind of response is the film going to get? Our audience is going to go out en masse. The early tracking numbers for Guardians of the Galaxy 2 were a pretty damn impressive $150 million they were predicting for opening weekend. However, since that time, some new information has come out. First piece of information is this, is that the advanced ticket sales for Guardians of the Galaxy are outpacing Avengers Age of Ultron. Now, Avengers Age of Ultron eventually opened up to $191 million on opening weekend. Is that saying that Guardians of the Galaxy 2 will then maybe crack $200 million? I don't necessarily think so, because back when Age of Ultron came out, there still was not a significant portion, I think, of the movie-going audience that got into the idea of buying those tickets in advance. I still think the majority of filmgoers don't buy their tickets in advance, but every month more and more people are. So just because more people have bought advance tickets for Guardians doesn't necessarily mean it's going to outpace Ultron. I do think it's going to break 150, though. I'm going to peg it probably about, especially since it's like the only major film opening this week, and the other major film that's going to be out there is Fast and the Furious, which has already been in, it's going to be in theaters 4 weeks by the time Guardians drops. I see Guardians cracking 165. I don't think it's going to hit 190 or 200 million, but I think it's going to beat that $150 mark and hit maybe around 165 million. Mark, what do you think?
I'm going to go a little more conservative. No, I'm the guy that's not going to go $200 million for Guardians of the Galaxy Volume 2. I agree with you. I don't trust a lot of box office tracking to begin with. And when you talk about advanced ticket sales, Beauty and the Beast was also outpacing the first Avengers and the second Avengers as far as advanced ticket sales, but it didn't pan out quite as much as people thought it would, this guy included. It did very well, and I think it did better than Guardians of the Galaxy is going to do opening weekend. I have it around, I think 150 is a high number for Guardians. And so I would look around the 140, 145 range for Guardians of the Galaxy.
What do you think?
I think I'm more in line with you, John. I think I'm going to say 165 because it also opened in some international markets. And I think in those markets, at least, it exceeded expectations.
Yes, it did.
So it makes me think that I feel like tracking had this thing pegged at about 150. So it makes me think it's going to go a little higher. And wow, is this thing set up for the following week, too? Because opening weekend numbers is a huge deal, but so is the fact that a movie needs to have legs in order to actually make a significant profit. And the ones coming up next week are King Arthur, which I don't think is going to do all that much, and Snatched, which isn't really much of a competition for Guardians.
Yeah, and we're actually going to go see King Arthur tonight. So we're going to get a feeling of whether we think audiences might rush out and see that as well. But you're right, I think this one will probably have some decent legs as well.
You know what's pretty crazy is that the first Guardians opened, I think, in 2014, $94 million opening weekend. And that's when people didn't really know what the hell this thing was. They just trusted Marvel to make a fun movie based on the promos. So this one is definitely going to be an uptick from that.
All right, guys, we've reached that part of the show now for buy or sell. Here's how this works. In front of her ass, she's got a few other items in the world of movie news. She's going to run them down. Then those of us at the table are simply going to say whether we buy it or sell it. So, Ashley, what do we got?
Following the film's world premiere this past weekend as a secret screening at the Overlook Film Festival, A24 has released the new trailer for It Comes at Night, the new horror film from acclaimed filmmaker Trey Edward Schultz. The movie follows Paul, played by Joel Edgerton, who learns that an evil is stalking his family home as he secures everyone within his desolate home and the unnatural threat terrorizes the world. The order Paul has established with his wife and son is put to the ultimate test with the arrival of a desperate young family seeking refuge. It Comes at Night opens in theaters on June 9, 2017. Perri, buy or sell the new trailer for It Comes at Night?
I'm going to buy the trailer, but as someone who has seen the movie, and I love the movie, but it's one of those situations where, and I feel bad saying this to you guys when you just watched it, try to go into this movie knowing nothing about it because it was really exciting having only seen that teaser, which mainly focused on that creepy hallway, the red door, and some voiceover. I didn't really have any clue what was going on. You had that one creepy guy, so you know that there's some sort of virus or disease out there. But I went into it knowing pretty much nothing, and I think that's the way to do it. It's still, you know, I understand why they have to release a trailer like this because, you know, if you don't know A24, you don't know the people involved, this might not be your thing. You could see a teaser trailer like that and completely write it off. And there's certain things that happen in this fuller trailer that I think will catch more eyes, but this thing is freaking creepy, and it's got some elements to it that you wouldn't expect. It is not so much about whatever evil entity is out there. It's more so about these people and how the threat out there affects them. And it's a family that you really believe in. So the threat of a family member potentially dying at any given moment, that's what's so damn scary about this movie. It is so well shot. This director is something else. You're going to want to keep an eye out for this one.
Well, I thought the trailer was okay. But what makes me excited about it is that there's this little company called A24 that Perri is referencing. Start keeping your eye open for that name popping up on previews because A24 has very quietly gone about putting together a really interesting library. They did The Witch, which I thought was just fantastic filmmaking. They did Ex Machina, they did Green Room, they did Swiss Army Man. I mean, they are putting together this really impressive catalog of films that they put together. And that's when that pops up on the trailer now, A24. Now I'm interested. So I thought the trailer was okay, but just because that name of that production company is on there is what gets me into this.
I think A24 also did Free Fire, right? And they're doing a ghost story, which comes out later this year, which is not really a horror movie, but this one certainly is from this trailer. And what sold me on this trailer, it's a huge buy for me, is the creepy violin. I don't know if you could get another set. Is it a violin?
This movie has an excellent score.
Oh, my God.
Like, violins and drum beats, like, things that really do enhance every single scare, if you could call it that.
I mean, this thing, like, so you have the violin in, like, Jaws, like, the, you know, the burner, and then you have the one in Psycho, like, the ring, ring, and then this one is kind of a mix between the two. It very, very staccato, very scary. They always come at night, John. They never come at, like, 2 p.m, you know?
No. Okay. What's next?
The first official trailer has been released for 47 Meters Down, the survival horror thriller that stars Mandy Moore and Claire Holt as sisters on vacation who decide to go cage diving with great white sharks in Mexico. Spoiler alert, things don't go well. The movie was originally slated for an August 2nd, 2016 DVD and VOD release through Dimension Films, but when Dimension sold the rights to Freestyle Releasing, they decided to give the movie a 2017 release. Theatrical release and set. 47 Meters Down also stars Matthew Modine and will hit theaters on June 16th. Mark Barisell, the new trailer for 47 Meters Down.
Oh, well, Ashley, in football terms, this is a big old home run for me. I can't wait to see Sharks go after Mandy Moore and her friend. I am so looking forward to this movie. I think it could be like The Shallows I was really excited about, and the actual movie let me down a little bit. Probably the same thing is going to happen. My favorite part of this trailer is when the thing breaks, the cage breaks, right? And then they go, ah! And then they're down 47 meters, hence the title of the movie. And they're like, they still have the comm link, so they're up with the boat like, hey, the rope broke. You guys want to send some help? And the dude is like, don't worry. You're going to be fine. We're sending more air tanks down to you. Oh, thanks. So I can breathe longer while the shark is gnawing on my leg. You come down here and you rescue me. I paid $30 for this experience. You should be swimming down 47 meters. I love the way the sharks look. I like to tear this trailer. This did everything for me. And thank God the writer's strike ended today, because now it gives me hope for my screenplay, Amity Buffet, which is Jaws, except from the perspective of the shark.
Oh, wow. That's
yeah. It's a shark idea. And his buddies, they're going to go for a nice, it's like the Golden Corral for them.
Look, you tell me, hey, a shark movie with Mandy Moore and Matthew Modine. Okay, yeah, this sounds like a throwaway piece of garbage. Not interested. Watch the trailer. Bye.
Whee!
Completely bye. I mean, actually, I love trailers, whether it's horror or suspense thriller or whatever, that sets you up where you just instantly think, these people are effed. Like, they are completely screwed. Like, how the hell? And when that, just the way they set it up, the sharks look a little laughable, but whatever.
What is laughable about a great white shark looking you right in the eye, John?
Well, I mean, a real one, not much. Not much is, there's not much to laugh
those
at.
Those are real ones. This is the documentary.
Oh, is that what they did?
Yeah, it's a whole drama. This thing happened to Mandy Moore.
Hey, look, if the job of a trailer is to get you excited about a movie that I couldn't, you know, care less about, job well done. The trailer, now I want to see this movie. On that basis alone, I give it a buy.
Bye. I'm so excited for this. Just like I was excited for The Shallows. I had higher hopes for The Shallows being like a really good movie. This I want just to be fun, as long as it's fun. And that's what the trailer achieves. It's, you know, that point where you build up to that moment where the cage drops. It's like everybody, when we were standing around your computer watching it, everybody had a reaction, just like, oh my God, you know? So that's the kind of thing that this trailer needs to do. I just feel really bad for Claire Holt. You pitched it as the Mandy Moore, Matthew Modine movie, and you're like, Mandy Moore and her friend. Claire Holt is an actress, and she's pretty good.
Claire Holt is an actress going to get eaten by a shark, Perry. So when you look at this movie, too, unlike It Comes at Night, which that thing only comes at like 3, sharks do come at 2 p.m. Sharks are not, they'll come at any hour of the day. They're coming after you and your entire family. Here's what's cool about this movie, too, is that sharks.
True story. You would have loved this. So on my mother's side, I'm from the east coast of Canada, a little province called Nova Scotia, a city called Halifax. And so I've got family out there who are legit fishermen. Like, they're fishermen, right?
Yeah.
So one time we go out back to the east coast to visit family, and I'm just a young kid, and we decided to go out on my Uncle Surrey's boat, right? And he's going to go fishing. He's squid fishing. He's fishing for squid. They just put these big hooks down the water and they pull up tons of squid.
You Italian Canadians got to have your calamari, don't you?
Pretty funny. So I'm standing there on this boat and then I'm realizing, are those fins in the water? It's like, oh yeah, yeah. When we start pulling up the squid and stuff like that, it attracts the sharks. The sharks are here.
What?
It's like, wait. No one told me about this. Like, so we're on this little boat. Now, of course, I wasn't old enough to realize it's perfectly fine. We are completely, perfectly safe. There's nothing wrong here at all. But I just remember I was freaking the hell out. You would have liked being on that boat, I think.
Have you all ever done that, the VR thing? I think it's for PlayStation or whatever, the thing where you cage dive?
JT showed it to me.
So you cage dive, and what this trailer does a great job of is, like, because the waters are kind of murky, so you're looking around, and when you're doing the VR, you're like, okay, because the premise is you're cage diving for treasure. So you go down, you're like, oh, I'm just looking for treasure, and then my mind starts to go to Jaws, and I'm like, oh, God, there's going to be a shark somewhere. And you're looking around, and you're waiting for it, and then just boom, it's just right on you. It's so good. The trailer does a good job of that. Back to you, Ash. Sharks.
Is that my cue?
What's next?
In a recent interview with the French outlet Allociné, Alien Covenant director Ridley Scott confirmed that what most fans might have already known. Neill Blomkamp's long-in-development Alien sequel, which would have picked up the franchise's timeline after James Cameron's Aliens, has been canceled. The quote, which was originally printed in French, was translated by the folks over at Comic Book Resources. Speaking about the project, Scott said, There was never a screenplay, just an idea that evolved into a pitch of 10 pages. I was always just a producer, but it didn't go any further because Fox decided that it didn't want to do it. John Byersel, Neil Blomkamp's Alien sequel, ever seen the light of day based on Scott's comments?
Oh, even before Scott's comments, I would sell that it was ever going to see the light of day. Look, the writing was on the wall. Once Ridley came back into the picture and Alien Covenant got greenlit, you just kind of knew the writers. And then when Scott came out and said, I'm going to make more of these, it's like, okay, this is kind of dumb. This is done, Neil Blomkamp saying. And I think really what probably killed it more than anything else was, what was the name of the damn robot? Frenchie? Markie?
Chappie.
Chappie was terrible. It wasn't so good. And Elysium was a big letdown. I think a lot of people had super high expectations for Elysium going, especially because of how amazing District 9 is. But Elysium really was a big letdown. I think a lot of people convinced themselves it wasn't as bad as it was because we remember how good District 9 is, and then, you know, later on future viewings realizing it was quite bad, and Chappie was quite bad. And I think that is probably what killed it more than anything else. But it's interesting to hear him say that it was never actually all that far along. That he had an idea. There was, sure, he got some sketches made. He says he never got more than a 10-page like treatment. Okay, if that's the case, then it's not a ton of skin off of anybody's nose. But yeah, I completely sell that we're ever going to see Neil Blomkamp's Alien.
I don't think we're ever going to see his version of Alien, but there was definitely a time where I believed it was going to happen. Fox picked it up and announced it. It's just a really weird way to have handled this whole thing. It was almost like he was actually legitimately working on making that thing happen, and then Ridley Scott just popped up, and he's like, you know what? I want to do my thing, so that's the end of you, and what Ridley Scott says goes. So he just got a really, you know, he was in a really shitty situation where he did some work, and he got people hyped. He had Sigourney Weaver's ear. She was giving quotes for his movie. It had to have been in a position where it could have been realistic at a point. I feel kind of bad for Blomkamp with all the quotes that Ridley Scott has released about this, because it makes him seem, you know, he's not as important clearly in the Alien franchise as Ridley Scott is right now, but I don't know. It just doesn't seem like a very fair or nice way to handle it. And also, Chappie is not bad.
Well,
Chappie is not bad.
Neil Blomkamp is not as important in the Aliens universe as Lance Hendrickson at this point. I mean, he really hasn't really done anything for that franchise yet. What do you think about all this?
Well, I think Lance Hendrickson is very important to many franchises, like Aliens and Hard Target. But yeah, I sell this ever.
I love Hard Target.
Hard Target's great, and he's great in it. I sell this ever seeing the light of day for a lot of the reasons you guys are saying, but also like the one thing that the Neil Blomkamp version could always cling to is that Sigourney Weaver's excited about it. So we have Ripley, who's pumped to be in this project, but when you started hearing her talk about it, it seemed like they had like a script. It was like they're ready to shoot. As soon as Ridley Scott says, okay, let me make my movie, and then y'all go make your movies. And so when this really started to feel like the House of Usher is when Ridley Scott said, oh no, we're not just making Alien Covenant. We want to make like, I got three more of these in the can.
Yeah.
And now I don't know if those three movies, I don't know if he said, do those all take place before Alien?
Not sure.
Or does one of those take place? Because I would love to see Ellen Ripley back, and I want to see Sigourney Weaver play her after the events of Aliens. I would love to retcon Alien 3. If you think it's a cute movie and it's a nice early body work for David Fincher, that's fine. I'd love to get that out of the universe and have a proper sequel to Aliens. That's what I want to see. Neil Blomkamp, I loved Elysium. I loved District 9. I thought Chappie was pretty horrific. So I want to see him get back on the winning side of the ledger with something. Just doesn't appear it's going to be an Alien movie.
Well, guys, I want to remind you that this is not the only show on Collider Video. Today, we got a bunch of other things, including a brand new episode of John Schnepp and Heroes will be up. That goes live at 1 p.m. Pacific Standard Time. That's 4 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. Don't worry if you can't watch it live. You can just watch it a little bit later. That's fine, too. But that goes up today. And also, a little bit later today, a brand new movie trivia schmodown match between Team Action and Nerds Watch. Keep your eyes open for that. Of course, every Friday, brand new episodes of Jeremy Johns' awesome Tacular goes up. That's on Verizon Go 90. Make sure you subscribe there and pick that up. And also, to make sure you guys know this too, we are doing a little bit of an experiment this week. There's so much TV on every week that, you know, it's just, you cannot cover all the TV in one show a week. So we thought it would be important to try one full week of daily TV talk. We started yesterday. A new episode went up this morning. Make sure you go and check that out. And then make sure you tune in at 8 a.m. That's when it goes live. 8 a.m. Pacific Standard Time, 11 a.m. Eastern Standard Time. every day this week, Monday through Friday. And we're going to see, we want you guys to participate in this experiment with us. We're going to see if this is worth doing all the time. So make sure you watch these shows, comment, let us know your thoughts about how that's going. You guys are going to be a big part of determining whether or not we can take TV Talk daily, permanently moving forward. So go and check that out. All right, guys. Now, I want to also let you know that at the end of the show, we're going to save a little bit of time to take your live Twitter questions. So if you're watching us live right now, make sure you follow us on Twitter, at Collider Video. Start firing in some questions, and Wendy will pick a couple up. But before we get to those, we're going to go to our mailbag. So if you want to get in a mailbag question, just email us anytime at collidervideo@gmail.com. Ashley, what's in the mailbag?
Brandon writes, greetings, Collider crew. Recently, I've made it a goal to watch all the current AFI Top 100 movies. I've seen 41 so far. What movies released after 1999 would you add to this list, since currently there are none? My pick would be No Country for Old Men. Thanks, and may the force be with you.
Yeah, No Country for Old Men is, look, it's a gangbusters, awesome film, no doubt about it. I don't think it's the one that I would put on the list. I think if I had to pick one that would go up on there, might be There Will Be Blood. I think I might put There Will Be Blood on that AFI Top 100. I mean, that's that movie to me, right from that first like 10-minute scene where I don't even think there's any dialogue in the first 10 minutes, and like you're like completely riveted by the movie all the way through. And I think the best single performance by any actor given in any movie probably the last 20 years is Daniel Day-Lewis in this movie. I can't think of a film in the last 20 years where a single performance was that amazing, was that standout, and was it just held the film together the whole way through, held your attention the whole way through, right up to when the credits started rolling. So for me, it would probably be There Will Be Blood. What about you?
Well, if it was me personally, Step Brothers. But when you look at the AFI Top 100, you see that a lot of the films on there are, not only are they great movies, but they're also a sign of the times they were made, and that's why you have so many great Westerns and stuff like that on there. So if you're looking for something that not only is a great film post-2000, but also is an earmark as to the kind of world we were living in and the kind of movies that were being made then, I think there's two that I would throw on there. The Dark Knight is one that I think definitely belongs on any top 100 list of anything. And I also think 12 Years a Slave is something that I think you put on that list and it makes people say, oh, they were making important movies like this around this time period. So it makes me proud to have been alive during the time period when we're doing all these movies that are not only great entertainment, but they're also actually making important political or social messages as well.
Oh, I can't believe there's one I forgot as well. I mean, it'd be ridiculous. It is the record holder for the winner of the most Academy Awards, tied with Ben-Hur and Titanic. 11 Academy Awards for Lord of the Rings, Return of the King.
It's hard to keep the Lord of the Rings movies out because not only did that movie win Best Picture, the other two were nominated for Best Picture.
Yeah, and Return of the King, I said, won 11 awards. The only film ever to be nominated for over 10 awards and sweep. It like literally won every Academy Award it was nominated for. It was a complete sweep that year. That's going, and I, well, just me, I would put on my personal list Gladiator. I think Gladiator is an underappreciated film. I think the more and more time that goes by, I go back and watch that film, I realize just how brilliant it is. Anyway, what about you, Perri? What are ones you'd add?
Fellowship of the Ring was added for the list's 10th anniversary. And I feel like when they did the 10th anniversary, that was the only, you know, post-2000 movie that was added, which is kind of interesting. This is the reason, though, why there's a whole bunch of people that pick this list, because they're trying so hard not to just consider my own personal feelings, because I say it at the end of every year when we're like, oh, this is my top 10. This isn't the top 10 that I think is the most well-made movies of the year. These are just the ones that I enjoy and the ones that I was moved by most. But the three that I think I have a hard time choosing between are probably Inglourious Basterds, Mad Max, and Boyhood. Mad Max and Boyhood more so because just the way that they were made, the way that they were shot, and what they achieved with the storytelling in those two, I think it's incredible. But I think if I had to pick between those three, it'd probably be Inglourious Basterds. I have watched that movie God knows how many times. It's a great example of excellent performances. I mean, Christoph Waltz in that, that performance is up there as one of my favorite of all time. And when you watch that movie, it is so well written and so well directed, where I just love the way it's segmented, where I can remember every single moment of that movie. And there's tons of things out there, not Jurassic Park or things like Scream, where I've watched them and I can recite the whole thing. But movies that I would consider favorites where you can't remember every specific beat, there is just something about Inglourious Basterds where I could watch it over and over and never find a single second of that movie that I'm like, oh, it didn't really need that. It didn't really need that line of dialogue or that sequence. That is just an incredible piece.
And credit goes to Brandon, too, for seeing 41 of the movies on the 100 list so far. Do you all know your number?
I didn't calculate my number.
I'm at four. No, I'm at 68. I've seen 68 of those movies. There's one movie I could take off the AFI and replace with something else. Look, I love Tootsie to death. It's a funny movie. Bill Murray's great as the roommate. There's no way Tootsie should be in there over Animal House. A far superior comedy. Animal House belongs in the top 100.
Tootsie absolutely belongs on the AFI top 100.
It's a funny movie.
List.
It ain't Animal House, John.
Oh, it's a what? It's, you know, it's not just a great comedy. It's a great movie. Like, even if you take the comedy, it is a great movie. I don't know. I think you and I would have words over that.
Let's put Jaws 3D in there.
Although I am not disregarding your assertion that Animal House is a great movie.
God,
of course
it
absolutely is. All right, let's get to those Twitter questions. Wendy, what have you picked out?
The first one comes from Jay Miller, who writes, thoughts on The Dark Tower coming out tomorrow. They're talking about the trailer. I think it's long overdue.
Yeah, I mean, look, we actually talked about this yesterday. Yesterday I said, don't worry, it'll come out like within the next 2 weeks. There'll be a trailer. Then the next day, tomorrow is the trailer. Yeah, I don't know, again, just kind of echoing what we said yesterday, I don't know that it's overdue. The movie's 3 months away. I mean, so if they put out a trailer 3 months ago, it would have been forgotten by now and then lost in the sea of Guardians of the Galaxy and Fast and the Furious and Wonder Woman coming out as well. I think they had a specific plan about how they wanted to handle their marketing. I think they wanted to compact a lot of their marketing, they had their marketing budget, and instead of spending that marketing budget over 9 months, they decided we're going to spend it in 3 months and do a really full court press on this. And I think it's perfectly fine. I think 3 months out, it was not time to panic. Now, even I was like, I am curious why we haven't seen one yet, but I think we're still within that okay range. Like, 3 months out, I think, is fine. I don't know. What do you think?
Well, you talk about a lot of people who don't buy tickets in advance, how there's still the majority of tickets are sold at movie theaters. And so a lot of people are going to go see Guardians this weekend or see King Arthur next weekend or whatever else you see the rest of the summer. Now, Dark Tower is going to be in the ballgame. Now, when you go see a movie, you're going to see that trailer attached to it. It's going to get people talking. So it's the perfect time. Us fans, would we have loved to have seen a Dark Tower trailer 2 months ago, 6 months ago? Sure. It's fun little two-minute movies for us. But as far as a marketing strategy goes, it's fine to drop it right now. And I hope it's great.
I don't know. I'm a little nervous. And I think that's just because of all the delays and all the little bumps in the road that we've heard about. I think it might have been beneficial for them to start this campaign a little earlier, maybe not releasing a full trailer, but just to start getting, you know, buzz going, because there's a lot of fans of Dark Tower the book, but I mean, I don't really know all that much about it, and I own the book. I've read 20 pages, and I'm like, well, this is tough and dense. I'm going to save this for later, and then I never went back to it.
You sound like Mark Ellis.
I do, don't I? You know, some books are not for everyone, but Jurassic Park is. I'm going to bring you a Jurassic Park book, and I'm going to make you read it.
You know who I love in that book? Coggles Bloodworth, or whoever. What's the guy's name that they retconned in the new movie?
Ben Lockwood.
Yeah, yeah.
Coggles Bloodsworth?
He's not in the book.
It sounds like a Harry Potter character. It totally sounds like a Harry Potter character. All right, what's next?
Spider-Hawk writes, are there any Stephen King stories you would like to see come to the screen / remade beside those that are already in works? Christine, please.
What isn't being remade?
They've already done Christine a couple of times. Let's not forget, it was just like 2.5-3 years ago that there was another Christine was made, I believe it was. Or was Carrie, I'm thinking.
Carrie was remade.
Yeah, they didn't care. They haven't touched Christine yet. I mean, a haunted car is a pretty tough thing to go with, or a possessed car. I like the idea of Salem's Lot. That movie, the original movie way back in the day is just dreadful. I think they tried to reboot it as a TV show, which they've done with a lot of Stephen King properties. I'd like to see a proper telling of Salem's Lot again. The one that I'm a little cautious about, just because it affected me so much as a kid, is Pet Sematary. I think that movie still holds up. I think it's so scary the way they tell the story, not just the animals coming back to life, but all the backstory with the family and Zelda. Pet Sematary 2, still never seen it. Maybe you can build on that mythology. I just don't want to take away the original one.
I remember not too long ago, we did a story, might have actually been back still in the AMC days, we did a story about how there was reports of a Pet Sematary remake, but then never heard anything about it again. You're right, I think that is one that would be ripe for a remake, is Pet Sematary.
Well, you know what, on Nightmares Tomorrow, we're talking about the crazy slate of Stephen King remakes that are either coming out, in development, or just have been floated by at some point and they're on an IMDb page, and it's an insanely long list, and because of that, that makes me not want to add anymore. I mean, the most recent one is The Firestarter, and I'm like kind of lukewarm on that idea. I don't really like the idea of Akiva Goldsman, of all people, directing that. I mean, I trust in him as a writer to a degree because he's got an Academy Award, but I don't know. I want some original content. There's so many Stephen King adaptations in the works right now. Let's not add anymore.
You know, the one you can never remake is Cujo. People do not want to see evil dogs. They do. They root for dogs Cujo. In movies now. You can't do Cujo again.
And Stephen, forgive me, but Shawshank Redemption was a Stephen King.
Shawshank Redemption, Green Mile, Stand By Me, and you can't touch any of those movies. Those are pretty classic as they are.
I'll get very angry if someone remakes Stand By Me.
Yeah. All right, what's next?
David writes, what do you guys think of another Boondock Saints is on the way with TV series along with it? Hashtag bring the filthy.
Nah, I want another true, legit Boondock Saints? You're damn right I would. I would love to go back and hang out with those characters all day. But we have heard over the years so many things. Oh, now there's another one. Oh, now there's TV. Oh, now there's going to be a miniseries. I'll believe it when I see it. Like, so would I like to see a true one? Yes. Am I interested in TV story with different actors and all that kind of stuff? Nope, not interested in that at all. But at this point, I'll just believe it when I see it.
It would be cool to see that cast back. So yeah. I'd be up for that. I'm not going to be marking my calendar by a new Boondock Saints TV show or whatever, but it's a great first movie, so I'd like to see them go back to that at some point. I think there's an appetite for it. I think there'd be a clamor. I think it would do well.
Oh, I don't know about that. One of the first movies that I ever covered and did interviews for was actually Boondock Saints 2, so I have a soft spot for these, but I don't think anybody really wants it all that much anymore, or it's just a very small group of people. So if this thing ever really does happen, I have a feeling it's going to be kind of like From Dusk Till Dawn, where, I mean, that show is still going, and it's with a brand new cast, but, you know, clearly it's got a really devoted fan base because they're still making more of them.
All right, let's take two more.
Okay, Lou Ferrigno wants to know, how do you determine all the lineups for each show each day?
It depends on who's on my good side that day. No, I mean, it's really a lot of time. We just plan out. We just try to balance it out. And we I mean, partially it's about who's available because, like, we have a lot of things going on in the office here. So, like, quite often, you know, Perri will be busy with things, or Christian will be busy with things, or Mark is going to be doing stand-up comedy somewhere, or whatever. So partially, it's about availability. But actually, really, Wendy, you're the one who does the scheduling for Movie Talk. So what are some of the big factors that go into that?
It really depends on one who's available, and it really depends on, I think, who the panelists and what story you want to cover, and also like what movies are coming out. If we are going to do a review, spoiler review, commentary. And it just all adds to it, but it starts with who I have that I'm able to schedule on a daily basis.
Oh, thanks. You don't need to compliment me. I mean, I'm right here. I'm blushing now.
All day, every day.
All right, what's next?
All right, this one comes from Logan, who writes, after the Justice League and Aquaman film, do you think Jason Momoa could be the next sought-after action star above Dwayne Johnson?
Above Dwayne Johnson?
That's a tall order.
Look, let's take that part of your question. Let's take the Dwayne Johnson part out. I have unabashedly been a Jason Momoa fan for a long time. I actually think that he did that. Oh, I'm forgetting the name of it now. That film he did with Sylvester Stallone,
Bullet
to the Head. You know what? Say what you want about the movie. I thought he was great in that. I thought Momoa was great in that movie. And actually, before they announced that Ben Affleck was Batman, I thought there was an argument to be made to let Jason Momoa be the new Batman. I mean, he's devastatingly handsome. I mean, he is a handsome dude. I think he's got the acting chops. I really do. And he clearly had the physical stature for Batman. I think they made the superior choice in getting Ben Affleck. I think that was a brilliant choice to get Ben. But I'm a huge Momoa fan. I think if he's positioned right and if his Aquaman character can hit with audiences, yes, I do think he will be a go-to action guy. Over Dwayne Johnson, let's not get ahead of ourselves. Probably not, no. But he could be that guy. Because right now, I think you can make an argument, there are like two legit action stars right now. And that's Dwayne Johnson and Jason Statham. I wouldn't even put Vin Diesel in there. And I'm a big Vin Diesel fan. But I wouldn't consider Vin a big action star as much as I would those two guys. And do I think Momoa could be the third? Yeah, I do. What do you think?
I was about to say yes to this question. Then they added a little bit at the end. Like, up there with The Rock. No. I really like Jason Momoa. If you see The Bad Batch, which I think it's coming out pretty soon. The movie has some issues. I didn't love the whole thing. But he is really good in that. And he's got a role where it easily could have been a kind of one-note thing. And he brings a lot to that part. So I'm a big fan of his. And just for the sake of accuracy, my comment about From Dusk Till Dawn, apparently the actors on that show were released from their contract, so it doesn't look like there's going to be a season four, but still, I give them a lot of credit because I never thought that show would make it past season one.
Oh, and by the way, yeah, Momoa's also got a Netflix series right now called Frontier. Doesn't get a lot of attention or a lot of love. I actually think he's really good on that, so you should check it out if you get a chance.
Yeah, he brings personality, charisma, and some serious acting chops to anything he's in. When we saw him in Game of Thrones as Drogo, it's like, oh yeah, this guy's great. He's a great looming presence, but we don't know if he can actually actually act. He can, and we got a little bit of that in Bullet to the Head when he's swinging an axe next to Sly, but then we're going to see that more as Aquaman and in Justice League. But I think he's going to be a great action star for a long time. I don't see him as Batman, though. Like, he's too shredded to be Batman. Batman is always a guy who's in good shape but needs to build a suit to give himself abs. Like, he doesn't do the crunches to earn the abs on his own. He's got a good stomach, but Batman never has, like, the shredded abs you want, so he had to build a suit for himself.
Wow. You're gonna get a lot of email today.
I only say that because I'm also a guy that would have to build a suit for myself if I wanted that.
All right, guys, that'll do it for this installment of Movie Talk. Thanks so much for joining us. I want to thank the people sitting at the table with me. First of all, right here, Miss Perri Nemiroff. Perri, where can people find you online?
I am on Twitter and Instagram at PNemiroff, and be sure to check out New Collider Nightmares. It's tomorrow. We're talking about so many great stuff. Clearly, Stephen King adaptations. My time at the Overlook Film Festival. It comes at night. A whole bunch of stuff. So check that out tomorrow.
Over here, we got Mr. Mark Ellis.
I'll be doing burpees at Crunch Fitness in about an hour, and you guys can find me this weekend in Nashville at Zany's Comedy Club. I'm there Thursday through Saturday. You can get tickets at markellislive.com. A bunch of my high school friends are going to be there, so if I'm a little inebriated on stage, I apologize.
Miss Ashley Mova.
Twitter, Instagram, Snapchat, Ashley Mova. Happy Tuesday, guys.
And, of course, Wendy Lee.
The Movie Couple channel on YouTube and at Wendy Lee Zany on Twitter, Instagram, and Snapchat.
And, of course, you guys can simply follow me on Facebook and on Twitter, just at John Campea. That'll do it for us, guys. Thanks so much for joining us today. Make sure you subscribe to our YouTube channel. And until next time, bye-bye.
Hey, guys, if you like this video, click the thumbs up button. Also, make sure you subscribe to our YouTube channel. It'll help you stay up to date with everything we've got going on here at Collider.